I spent most of my adult life growing up on sound stages. And we'd finish at 6 o'clock, and I'd hang around. I'd watch the swing shift come in and talk to them, you know. And I'd be there till 8 o'clock at night before I go home.
The first film that you made was Hoppy Serves a Writ.
I believe so, yeah.
In 1943.
Mm.
Obviously, the studio liked you, and I guess you liked the work. Because in 1943, you went on, in your first year in the business, to make 18 motion pictures.
I don't know, but I did a lot.
At the time, do you remember whether you said to yourself, well, this is a pretty good way to make a buck?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. I was getting $100 a week and all the horse manure I could carry home, you know. All the singing and supper on the ground, out playing cowboys and Indians out in the outdoors, you know.
Yeah. So, in effect, you said to yourself, all right, I'm going to stick with this. This is where I want my life to go.
Not that so much as I got stuck with it.
You got stuck with it.
Yeah.
Have you ever regretted getting stuck with this?
Not at all.
Through. Come on out and talk.
In the whole panorama of what you have to do as an actor, what is it that gives you the most satisfaction?
Getting away with it.
Yes. Yeah.
Several years ago, Larry Olivier was out here, and he was staying at a house in Malibu. And I was in a house next door, so he called me over, and we went over and chatted. And Larry said, you know, Bob, he said, I can't get away with this forever. He said, people are catching on, you know. They're getting wise. I can't, you know. And I think that's the best part, you know, being able to get away with it.
You have acted in more motion pictures than any other actor. Over 100 films. Are there any that are particular favorites?
Oh, Lord. Of course, there are a great many that I've never seen.
Why is that? Is that because you would
can't
often
find a place to park? No, I think Heaven Knows, Mr. Allison, I enjoyed.
Do you remember getting the script? Do you remember making that decision that was a film that you wanted to do?
Very strange thing. I was working in England. I was just finishing up on Fire Down Below with Jack Lemmon and Rita Hayworth. And I was coming off the stage, and a fellow came up to me and said, would you suppose, Bob, that you could be free on Saturday to make some tests? I didn't know what he meant, you know, Rorschach test, saliva test, but I see, I guess so, yeah. I said, well, he said, I'm sorry, he said, I should have introduced myself. He said, I'm Ozzie Morris. He said, I'm John the cinematographer.
Meaning John Huston.
I didn't know.
Oh,
I said, John who?
Yeah, sorry,
he
didn't
said,
need to
oh,
step
John
up.
Huston, you know. Well, I knew nothing about this. So I said, sure. So they went out and rented a couple of Marine uniforms, you know, we shot the tests. And then I don't remember when, as a matter of fact, I got the script. But I came from England, and I came back to Los Angeles, and turned around and made the trip right back again to Trinidad, this time, of course, armed with the script. I started off doing all the rough stuff, you know, that we could do without Deborah first. I had to swim underwater across the river. When I emerge into this deserted camp, you know, and things kept knocking into me in the water, and I thought there were logs floating down. So I asked what they were after. They printed the shot. They said, oh, that's the caiman, man, the alligators. You know?
Oh, God.
Now they tell me, you know, after. One time, Deborah and I are in the cave, and the explosions are going off, you know. She dug her fingernails into me. She said, what are we doing? I said, I thought you knew. And John, you know, saw her confusion. He said, hold it. What's the matter? He said, don't you know what you're doing? We said, no, John. He turned around to the assistant, Adrian Price Jones. He said, what are we doing, Adrian? But occasionally, we'd come down on the beach, and John would say, oh, it's too nice a day. We'll do it tomorrow. And that's great.
1954, River of No Return. Marilyn Monroe, Otto Preminger. What was Monroe like in that?
She was fine, you know.
Yeah, that was the beginning of her career.
Was it?
Yeah, yeah, that was...
Well, of course, I had known her, you know, before that.
Yeah.
Because she was... I worked with her husband at Lockheed.
Really?
And Jim Doherty.
No, and that was her first husband?
Yeah. She was, you know... She had that drama coach with her.
Strasberg?
Huh?
Lee Strasberg?
No, no, no.
This was before...
Natasha Lyttas. I worked with her on radio occasionally. She was always being removed from the cast just at the last moment. And she would stand behind the camera and signal, you know, Marilyn. Marilyn didn't know it. And the furniture would catch her, you know, and threaten to kill her. But Marilyn was open, you know, and pleasant and nice. She was standing by the camera one day. She had to run out and just walk out into the river and cut a rope, cut the raft loose. The river comes off the glacier, so there's also sort of powdered stone on this. It's very slick on these round stones.
Mm-hmm.
So she's standing by the camera, and she said, "It is the panic of considered flight." I said, "What?" She said, "It is the panic of considered flight." And I said, "Honey, don't run out there, because you run out there in that river, you're going to fall and break your leg." She said, "It is the panic of considered." I said, "Panic, panic." I said, "You run out there, you're going to break your leg." Otto says, "Action." She runs out there and broke her leg.
And was this panic of considered flight, was this in the script?
What do you think? No,
was
something
a tip from her drama page?
Yeah.
Anything like that, I'll forget that you're a woman.
I doubt that.
Just take my word for it, fool. You know what you're doing?
I think I do.
Do you know this? You know how long we'd last out here without that raft, without the rifle? The whole country alive with Indians? Just how many kinds of fool are you?
I'm not your kind.
You know, she didn't think she was very pretty. And she wasn't, you know, she was not sexy.
Yeah.
And she was very, very shy. And so she constantly made fun of herself, you know. She was constantly burlesquing herself. And she was very unsure of herself. We were very good friends, you know, so we got along very well. But she was trying very hard, you know. She wanted to please everyone. And she wasn't so sure that she could. She thought that hers was a case of mistaken identity, you know. Mm. I mean, I think we all feel that way. I mean, I know I feel it.
How so?
Well, you're talking to him, you know, not me.
Like when people say, that's Robert Mitchum. Probably heard, you've heard this.
I turn around to look too.
Movie star, I'll check it out,
yeah.
Right? Yeah. Once when someone asked you why you work so much, you said, I work cheap and I do my own stunts.
Well, that was true.
Yeah. You started early on just doing your own stunts. Did you do it because you thought it was part of the business, because you enjoyed it, or?
I thought it was part of the business. I didn't know. I was 2-3 years into it before I wound up on the bottom of the pile, and one of the stuntmen said, "Hey, man, we get paid for this." And I discovered that they were getting more per stunt than I was making a week.
Were you ever sorry that you did your own stunts? I mean, did you ever either get injured in it or find it that it was just, it ended up being a bad choice to make?
Yeah, certainly.
Anything come to mind?
Well, let me see. Now, I have 2 broken ankles, broken back, broken neck, broken shoulder. I don't know how many broken ribs.
When I read about you, I came across a lot of nice things that a lot of directors said about Robert Mitchum, but none more so than Charles Laughton. You knew him as a friend, and then he directed you. Were there any surprises?
Well, I found his lack of projected ego somewhat surprising. He was concerned with what was going on.
The script for Night of the Hunter was written by James Agee.
Jim Agee wrote a treatment.
Yes.
And it came out like a WPA project, you know, it was 8 inches thick. And we had a time, you know, we had a date to begin. So Charles undertook the script. And at the same time, mind you, he was dramatizing the Kane Mutiny Court Martial for the theater.
Yeah.
Which opened in San Francisco.
Yeah.
So he was laboring on both projects, and he, in effect, really did write the script.
Although Agee got credit for it.
Yes, well, Charles would not assume credit for it. Charles worked very closely with the set director and the scenic artist, you know, on the film. For instance, there's one scene where the two kids wake up in the loft and they say, hearing the preacher singing, and they look out and say, "Don't he ever sleep?" That was done on the stage with a midget on a midget pony. Almost simultaneously working on Night of the Stranger and Night of the Hunter, you know, almost, they like overlapped. You know. Worked out very well, actually, you know. We all had to check in. I checked into Wardlow Hospital, the Veterans Hospital, and that was kind of an experience for me. Frank wouldn't do it. He said, "I don't like sick people," and he walked out. Brad took one look at the first opening, you know, and he went and got a half a glass full of spirit alcohol and then knocked that back. Forget this. Olivia got to like it. She was became an operation freak, you know.
Isn't that interesting?
Yeah.
Henry Hathaway did a film with you called Five Card Stud.
Five Card Stud. I did a thing called White Witch Doctor with Henry. And the minute Henry was off the set, he was the greatest, most generous gentleman. The minute he walked on that set, he put on the black hat, man.
Really?
Oh! He screamed, "Fire people, you fire half the crew." I'd leave the set. I said, "Where are you going?" I said, "You can't work without a crew, Henry." He said, no, don't, you know. He used to just put them on all the time.
Was that common, that a director would be a gracious person or a nice person, and then suddenly you put them in that chair, you get them on the set, and they would turn
out Hathaway, that was him. I mean, that was his.
Did you ever confront this, confront him with it?
All the time.
Why are you acting like this? I know you're a nice guy.
All the time.
And did he have any response for it?
Not really, no. I remember I had a stand-in. Came back from lunch one day. He says, "You know, Henry started out as a prop man."
As a prop man?
Prop man, yeah. He said, "Hey, Henry," he said, "I was having lunch with a guy today." He said, "He used to know you when you was a prop man." He said, "You was a miserable bastard even then." And Henry said, "But I was a good prop man."
You know, I'm kind of tired of shooting at tin cans and bottles.
We still have some cartridges left.
And we're certainly not going to shoot at each other, are we? How about,
Well, 6 out of 6. Can't do better than that. You can only do worse.
Oh, no, my shooting was way off.
Way off? 6 out of 6?
I was aiming at the spaces in between.
When you look back, can you think of any films that you turned down and then were sorry later that you didn't do them?
No.
Not one?
No. Let me see, I turned down Dirty Harry. But you may surprise you to know that so did Frank Sinatra and so did Bill Cosby. None of us wanted to do a violent film.
Yeah.
And I turned down Patton for my own reasons, you know. I've never regretted it.
What were your reasons for turning down Patton?
I had done The Longest Day, and then I was in back east in Washington, I guess, and I met a guy named Ayers who had written a book called Before the Colors Fade, who was a nephew or somehow related to Patton. And he suggested to Frank McCarthy, and it came about like that. So it was presented to me sort of as a gift, you know, as a bonus.
Yeah.
And I thought, well, they're going to make it in Spain. They're going to use up all that World War II hardware. They're going to clank it back and forth in front of the screen, and they're going to rack it up for $14 million to the stockholders. And they're going to simply walk away from the character of Patton, who was a remarkable character.
Yeah.
So I said, and I'll say, well, so, you know, that's the way it is. And I said, I think they should get somebody who will really fight for the character, really, you know. Mm. So I suggested they get George Scott, which they did, and I think it worked out very well. And he did fight for the character. Since then, people have told me that he hated the character Patton.
Maybe he ended up using that in the film. Maybe that's one of the reasons why it works.
But I just knew that if I did it, I would say so, you know. But if he found somebody who really fought for the character,
yeah,
then it would be more than just a film.
I'm going to give you another film, El Dorado.
Oh.
He played this sheriff, this drunken sheriff.
That was a funny routine. I was in Chicago visiting a friend, and Howard Hawks called me, and he said, Bob, what about doing a Western with Duke Wayne? And I said, sounds great. He said, where do you want to shoot it? He said, I thought we'd do it down in old Tucson, you know. I said, wonderful, you know, I love that location. You know. So I said, what's the story? Oh, he said, no story, Bob, just character. That was it. We're working down in Arizona. I got shot in the leg.
In the film, or really, yeah. Truly shot in the
film? Yeah. So I wrote it, but no. I have to carry the crutch under my left arm. I said, no. The crutch substitutes for the injured member.
Yeah.
And Duke said, Jesus. He said, I used to break my leg every Saturday afternoon. And Howard said, besides, it leaves your gun hand free, Bob. So now this leg is gimped, and I've got the crutch under this, so I'm hippity-hopping all. We get back to the studio. We had to reshoot that scene because of the light. This time, I am very definitely shot in the right leg. And we go from there directly into the sheriff's office. And we have arbitrarily stung Duke in the leg with shotgun pellets, which they just pick out, you know, nothing really serious. We had a doctor, a young Canadian doctor. And he said, oh, no, the crutch substitutes for the injured member. So then I have the crutch under my right arm. I come back from Rush's one day, and Paul Helmick is saying, oh, my God. And I said, what is it? He said, every time you make an entrance, interior, exterior, your crutch goes. So finally, Mr. Hawks comes walking in, swinging his cane, and Paul went up and said, Howard, we have a big problem. I said, oh, what's that? So Paul explained it to him, and Howard said, oh, they'll never notice that. That was it. We get to the end of the picture, and Howard said, and I'm sitting in the sheriff's office, and Duke is getting ready to take off and go across town to visit the madam. And Howard said, all right, Bob. Now, he said, you were a writer. Now, what do we do about this? So So Duke picks up his crutch and starts out, and I said, that's my crutch. And he said, well, where's mine? I said, right under your nose. So he picks it up and starts out. I said, you got it under the wrong arm. He said, how would you know? You've been switching the back and forth. Yeah. Everything. That was it.
Sure, it looks like you're going to keep your job.
Yeah, it'll be a nice, quiet town after you leave, Cole.
How do you know I'm leaving?
Well, we just don't need your kind around here.
When you look at the press and the what journalists have written over the years, and they never seem to get it right, or I mean they rarely seem to get it right, what is it you think that they get wrong about you?
I don't know whether it's something in the transmission between the voice and the ear. I know one time in England, notorious, there was some journalist that came into my room with the Dorchester, and he had been so demanding, you know, he was so frantic. I said, okay. And the minute he walked in, I knew I should have walked right on out the window. So he said, how do you like London? And I said, I love it. You know, I said, I'm very fond of it. I enjoy it here. What don't you like about it? I said, well, there's nothing in the particular that I don't like about it. You know, if they put up parking meters on Grosvenor Square, you know, it wants me not. I enjoy it. I've got the best of it here. I'm here in the West End. You know, I've got a lot of friends here and good restaurants. And I said, well, if you could change anything about it, what would you change? I said, I might suggest that you move it a bit closer to the airport. And he said, yeah, why's that? And I said, well, although I enjoy the refresher course, you know, coming in from Heathrow and seeing all the chimney sweep signs and the pubs and so forth, I said, I am rather anxious to get in and get on with it, you know, because I enjoy it. Next day, somebody showed me the copy. How do you like London? We inquired of Mr. Mitchum. Too goddamn far from the airport, growled the burly Yank.
There are a lot of times that someone will say, you know, what we need to get for this is a Mitchum type. Let's get a Bob Mitchum type. And then they turn around and they find out that there is no Mitchum type, that there are no actors who do just what you do.
I remember when I first heard that, because I went along for a long time, you know, and I was no type at all. When after all the Westerns, you know, they'd say, no, we can't use him, he's from Texas. I said, I'm from Bridgeport, Connecticut. Did you hear that? He talks, he's got a Texas accent, you know.
Yeah, they heard what they wanted to hear.
Exactly, yeah. So it was a long time before anybody said, well, we need kind of a Mitchum type.
When you go back and you look at it now, you started in this business 43. That's a formidable career.
June 42.
What, really? What happened in June 42?
I got my go kart.
And that was the point where you felt that you were an actor?
No, that's when I got my first job.
Was there another point down the line when you felt you had made it?
The first year I made $3,000. I figured, okay, I was now a reputable citizen.
If you hadn't done this for a living, what do you think you might have done?
God knows. My job is to simply walk in, you know, say the jokes and clock out.